Introducing, hosting from the Portuguese section of Massachusetts, representing those that choose the Sioux, representing for all his boys mocked because they can't see colors, the man, the king, the motherfucking god of this pod, Matt Souza.
Hosting from the taint of America, representing that fuck, marry, kill game, representing for all the dudes in the group chat, Central Time, representing the motherfucking late club, it's Gen DK.
North-South Connection and Matt Souza. My name is Jennifer Smith. I am your co-host for GCDub, a game-changing podcast. How are you, Maddie?
Always great to be here. Always great to talk with you, Jenny. Got a lot of stuff to talk about, as is customary. We got big stuff upcoming, a couple of huge shows coming up that we'll be talking about later on in this episode. But you were also very busy, as one of the past shows we'll be talking about, you were in attendance for. So
luckily enough, I was. Yes, I was. So we'll get to that. And I would like to call attention to my Mancer era t-shirt, even though you know what? People referring to any of their eras is very annoying to me. I feel it is overused and overplayed quite a bit. Mm-hmm. But look, I got to meet Mancer.
Yep.
He sold me this t-shirt and I gave him his money because I wanted to support him. So regardless of what his shirt says, we are in our Mancer era.
Yeah, I was looking at that shirt on his, I think it was his official website, and I didn't pull the trigger on it yet, but I'm probably going to at some point, either that one or one of the other shirts he has on there. So, but I do like the Mancer era shirt. It's just the look of it, the black with the white.
Yeah, it just kind of fits GCW.
Yeah, like, it's a good look.
You know, I love it a lot, and, you know, Mance has been quite the champion so far.
Mm-hmm. And he's been very good, and as we'll talk about, he's done some more stuff here. He's on a roll as champion. He's been great so far. Mm-hmm. So looking forward to seeing what's coming for him next for sure.
Yeah, I have all kinds of thoughts, and there's stuff I want to get into on this episode that I think is a little bit different from what we've talked about before. But before we do all that, we can get into some of the results from the past month.
Mm-hmm. So we go all the way back to July 18th, which may as well have been 7 months ago, for Believe Me 2024 in Louisville.
Not Louisville.
It was in Louisville, believe it or not. Shane
don't call it Louisville. It's Louisville.
Care. Don't you? It's Louisville, as we learned on during the Return of the Living Dead episode.
We did.
Freak Out Drive-In. Go back and listen to that one, kids.
Imagine a movie set in Louisville.
In Louisville, a zombie movie.
A zombie movie in
Louisville, of all places.
If our listeners are not familiar with my past shows, which they might not be, I have a show called Freak Out Drive-In. It is a horror movie live watch, and Matt and I watched a movie set in Louisville, and we had quite the time.
I'm sure did it. I listened to that show not that long ago again. It's very good. But we go to Louisville as we have Shane Mercer beating Nate Webb, Bobby Flacco beating Facade, Masha Slamovich successfully defending the JCW title against Cole Radrick, Sam Stackhouse defeating Hunter Drake, Effie defeating Sean Ross Sapp. That's a hell of a thing.
Yeah, did not watch that match.
Hoodfoot defeating Broski Jimmy. Billy Starks beat Rachel Armstrong. One Called Manders and Too Tough Tony beat The Rejects. And Mance Warner successfully defended the world title against Myron Reed. So I did see some. I think this was the show that was on like a random Thursday night, if I remember right. I did see some of it. Effie and Sean Ross Sapp was fine. It was like one of those like weird. I kind of want to say like a celebrity match, but it you know what, it's one of those type of things.
Look, where, that's a reach.
No, I know.
I feel you. Yes.
It's like that type of thing, you know, right. With a lot of like smoke and mirrors, I guess is the right way to say it. So, and it was actually pretty good for what it was. Manders and Too Tough Tony match was good. I think this was supposed to be. It was supposed to be Too Tough Tony and Nick Gage, if I remember right, but Gage was still dealing with that injury he had, so Manders replaced him, and that was super fun. That was like a pretty fun brawl, and another great Mance Warner title defense here against Myron Reed. It's interesting to see Mance work against a guy like Myron Reed, who's kind of like a high flyer, so it was kind of different. Than it was still violent, but it had like more different stuff than what we've seen out of Mancer, so it was pretty cool to see that. But yeah, this is what I saw. I didn't see the whole thing, but what I saw of the show was pretty fun in Louisville.
Now, do we want to talk about Cole here or later on in the show?
I mean, we could bring it up. It's I want to say he only has like one more match. Just
that's what I was thinking. It was the next show.
Yeah. So I mean, we might as well just mention it here. Mm-hmm. I think that. Yeah.
Yeah, Cole got injured. He broke his leg.
Something like that. I don't know if he specifically said what it was, but it was something along the lines of some sort of leg injury, thigh injury, something like that. Which, again. Been a lot of injuries lately, and it's like, Jesus Christ, here's another one now. Yep. Like, just brutal.
It's a huge blow. Like, Cole is one of my favorites, and I follow him on the social, and you know, I see from his posts what wrestling means to him.
Yep.
And you know, like a lot of these guys, when you're sidelined, it's a huge blow.
Yep.
And I feel really bad for him. Like,
yeah, it's
same way I felt for Sawyer, you know.
Yep.
And
Jordan Oliver.
Yeah, just and they've been working so hard for so many years, and it's really tough to see these injuries like sideline them for months and months.
Yeah, I mean, you can see that Cole is a guy like wrestling is his life, you know. Yes. And say him and Jordan Oliver, I think, are very similar when it comes to wrestling, where it's like wrestling is kind of all they know, it's in their blood, you know, and to have it taken away from both of them in like almost back-to-back weeks, I think it's fucking brutal. So all the best to him, obviously. Hopefully hopefully he's back soon, but goddamn, another blow to this roster.
It's rough.
It's brutal. So then we go to the next day in Saugat, Illinois for So High, as Los Desperados defeated Bangin' Matthews. Manders defeated Broski Jimmy in a hardcore match. Galeno Del Mal defeated Jack Cartwheel. Zilla Fatu defeated Sam Stackhouse. Sidney Akeem defeated Myron Reed. Cole Radrick and Effie defeated the Rejects. Hunter Drake won a five-way scramble against Bobby Flacco, Camaro Jackson, Ken Broadway, and Morgan Dash. Megan Bain defeated Shane Mercer. And in the main event, it was Mance Warner defending the world title against Hoodfoot and successfully defending the title in a death match. And that was a hell of a match.
Yeah. So
perhaps I'll talk about it more later. Okay. I have a few that I may mention, but it was right up your alley. Death match, glass, light tubes. So
yeah, it's really like, I guess this is our 17th one of these podcasts since we've started on GCDub, and I still don't know what's going to be, you know, like a deathmatch show and what is not going to be a deathmatch show. And so it makes it hard for me to like decide which shows to watch, because if I'm being honest, for GCW, I want the blood. I want the light tubes, I want the weapons, I want all of it. I don't want a watered down version of GCW.
Right.
And I gotta get better at recognizing which one of these shows are gonna be for me.
Well, it's tough too, because like, I think it's fair to say that Jersey, when they run Atlantic City, you're probably gonna get a death match on this show.
100% I can count on Atlantic City. Saugat, Illinois, I was not expecting that to be, you know,
but even like
one of those cities.
So they've done two shows in Hartford so far. The one I went to had no death matches. They had like hardcore stuff with like the doors and stuff, but they didn't have light tubes. And then the second one I didn't go to had a couple of matches with light tubes in it. So it's like, how do you, it's tough to tell. Like, I don't know if it's like an athletic commission thing or if it's just like the building doesn't want to fucking clean up glass after a show, you know? Mm-hmm. So it's kind of hard to figure out like where exactly they can do it. So
that will come into play later on, I believe, in the show, too.
So then, this was a three-show weekend, as on the 20th of July, we had Don't Tell Me What to Do in Indianapolis, as Bangin' Matthews beat Bobby Flacco and Hunter Drake. Myron Reed beat Jack Cartwheel. The Rejects defeated Manders and Cole Radrick. A four-way match went to a no contest between Count Noctis, sounds like a Castlevania villain, Dex Royal, Morgan Dash, and Rachel Armstrong. Blake Christian and Shane Mercer defeated Effie and Joey Janela. Galeno Del Mal beat Arez. Zilla Fatu defeated Hoodfoot. Nate Webb beat Broski Jimmy. And in the main event, it was Mance Warner, again, defending his world championship for the third time this weekend. So he's defended it successfully against Megan Bain. And that was a very good match, too. Megan Bain, like, I know we've talked about her before, but, like, kind of out of nowhere, she's been on these shows, and she's been awesome for all of
them. Yes. She is on my radar, like, 1,000%. Like, I love seeing her name come up on there, even though I don't, like, necessarily get to watch all these shows. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm following her, right? I'm noticing all these matches that she's getting in GCW, winning. This is her first loss in a hot minute because she's been on a streak.
Like, she's main eventing shows with Mance Warner.
Main eventing. That's insane.
She's teaming with Joey Janela on shows. So, like, kind of out of nowhere, too. Yeah, and she's been awesome. Like, she's more than deserving of the spot. That Mance match was great. She had the eye still taped up from that attack from Mance a couple weeks before. So, yeah, I did see that. That was a very fun match. Zilla Fatu continues to impress the hell out of me. Being such a fucking rookie and having like 20 matches under his belt and being that fucking good. Like, it's crazy how good he is. Turns out the Samoan family, they're very good at the wrestling
thing. It's weird. It's totally weird. And I'll have much more to say about Zilla.
Is this a thing people know, that the Fatus are very good at the wrestling thing?
I think people are kind of cluing in on it.
Yeah, a little bit. So then we go
the secret's out, Matty.
Oh, wow. Finally.
Acknowledge him.
I have been. Every fucking episode. We go to July 28th. Josh Barnett's Bloodsport 11 from New York City. As, oh boy, I'm going to butcher this one. Hedy Karawi defeated, we'll go with that, defeated Brian Johnson. Julius Creed defeated Matt Makowski. Masha Slamovich defeated Jody Threat. Royce Isaacs defeated Charlie Dempsey. Speedball Mike Bailey defeated Akira. Brutus Creed defeated Tom Lawler. Homicide beat Mike Santana. Josh Barnett beat Bad Dude Tito. Josh Woods and Timothy Thatcher fought to a draw, which I think that was a double count out, actually.
What are we doing?
Yeah, that wasn't great. And in the main event, Shayna Baszler defeated Miyu Yamashita. This was a hell of a show from top to bottom. I watched the whole thing. It was on like a Sunday afternoon, just sitting at home doing nothing. Just awesome stuff. I love the Bloodsport shows. I got to try to get to one next time they come around here or something.
Those look fun. Not going to lie.
Yeah, it was just super fun. Speedball and Akira was like one of the best 3-minute matches I've ever seen.
I was going to ask you about this time. It was 3 minutes of this match. That's crazy.
Like, Akira got cut open by a kick at one point. Like, definitely seek that match. The whole show, like, top to, and it was a quick show, too, because, like, it was 10 matches, but all
everything
the matches
is under, like, 10, like, the most is like 9.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Charlie Dempsey and Royce Isaacs was really great, too. Charlie Dempsey, William Regal's kid, if you're not familiar, he wrestles down in NXT. That match was super fun. Just, yeah, from seeing Homicide, who's one of my favorite guys, period, in this type of setting, too, was awesome. So
I know you love some Homicide.
Just top to bottom, a fantastic show. And I think the show overall was like 2.5 hours, too, so you can watch the whole thing in super quick fashion. But, yeah, honestly, like, one of my favorite GCW shows of the year, I think.
That's awesome. Yeah. Those Bloodsport shows, I think, are kind of like elite in GCW. Mm-hmm. Seems that way. And it's such a cool concept.
It's usually a thing they do Mania weekend, and this is
yeah, that's what I was thinking.
This is like one of the rare ones they did. And the problem with them doing it Mania weekend is, I think in Philly they did it at like Thursday at four o'clock in the afternoon.
Yeah, we
like,
missed it.
I had just gotten to Philly like an hour beforehand, so that would be a cutting it close. But so then we go to the show that you were at, Jenny. Now and forever in the Cleve, I think they call it Cleveland. Bang. I don't know why I said that.
Nobody
Bang.
Calls it that.
I just did. Bang and Matthew. We do now. Bang and Matthews defeated CPF. Ali Catch beat Sunny Kiss. Sydney Akeem beat Gringo Loco. Zilla Fatu defeated Josh Bishop. Lucha Guys of Rez, Galeno Del Mal, and Jack Cartwheel defeated Alec Price, Dustin Waller, and Marcus Mathers. Effie and Raj Desi, who is the former Jinder Mahal, fought to a no contest. Manders defeated Isaiah Broner, Paro, and Sam Stackhouse. Cool Ass Andy and Mance Warner fought to a no contest in 1 minute. And then immediately after that, Matthew Justice returned to GCW and lost to Mance Warner in a non-title match. It was Pick Your Poison, if I remember right. Blake Christian and Shane Mercer defeated Los Macizos. Damn, there's a lot of matches on this show. Monkey Ito defended the Extreme title against John Wayne Murdoch. And in the main event, Nick Gage returned to the ring and fought Matt Hardy to a no contest. Jenny, the floor is yours.
Okay. Now, like I said earlier, I've been to GCW shows where we do light tubes and we do death matches, and then I've been to ones where we don't.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, Detroit last summer was my all-time favorite show I've ever been to in my entire life because they went balls to the wall in that show, and nothing has lived up to that.
Mm-hmm.
GCW, nothing has lived up to that show, in my opinion, because when I'm feral, that's what I want to see. And when I go to these GCW shows, that's what I want to be, is feral. I don't want to, it's a different Jenny than you find at a SummerSlam or a WrestleMania. Mm-hmm. Those are hyped Jennies, but not GCW Jennies.
Right.
And I talked about the show after with a couple of people in our group, and you know, it's like a couple of excuses. Like, this is the first time they run Cleveland, and they didn't know about the draw of it because the crowd was a little light. I don't think it wasn't a small crowd,
right?
But a unique venue,
and it was a decent sized building. Too,
it was
wasn't
a decent sized building, and it wasn't sold out. Like, obviously, you're not filling that spot, but they had the guardrails up around the ring too, which was highly annoying for me.
Yeah.
Like, and I'm on the second row this time. I did not enjoy that. I'm a front row girl. I just want to be front row at GCW.
Right.
And this show was so long. I'm not typically the one that's sitting there yawning during GCW. And I did during the show. I could not stop yawning. And I kept waiting. And I kind of knew it wasn't going to happen with the light tubes, but my heart of hearts just kind of kept waiting for it. Like, maybe in the main event, something different for Matt Hardy. I don't know. Not sure if he wanted to do all that. Probably not.
Right.
I definitely understand all of those things, but on a extremely personal level, of course I love the show. I always love being at the show. Zilla was a highlight for sure. That guy's a fucking superstar.
Yep.
I got to meet him on the street the day after this show, which was amazing.
Mm-hmm.
He was amazing, and I would not change that for anything, but I'm going to call this a tad bit disappointing.
No.
And I don't want to have a show where I sit here, and I know you don't either, sit here and shit talk anything that GCW does. Like, it's the reason we started the show, is because we loved it and the vibe that it had.
Yep.
And I don't know if I'm alone in this, but booking decisions and then having these non-hardcore, non-deathmatch, non-violent shows is not what I'm there for.
Right.
Ultimately, at the end of the day, I want to go and see the blood. I want to see violence. I want to sweat. I want it to be gross.
Right.
That's how I feel. And that's what I feel like GCW is. And I'm rambling a lot. And I just have a lot of intense feelings about it. But also, I don't want to come across as negative or hating on anything. And that's very important to me.
Right.
I'm not hating on any of this.
No, I mean, it was the no contests are starting to bug me, too.
The main event was so disappointing.
Especially in the main event. That's the one I look at, and it's like, what are we doing? Why did that, like...
And I get it, like, Matt Cardona came out, and they're hyping Homecoming. They're hyping future shows, and I'm sorry, but that's not what we do here.
Right.
Like, we're in the moment where we're in GCW, and that's how I've always felt. And other promotions, I can get the long-term, the booking, the storytelling, and all that, but it's just not where my heart is when it comes to this promotion.
That's what it feels like with some of this stuff, and maybe it's by design, I don't know, but by design meaning like with the Cardona being general manager character is what I mean, where it feels like almost like a WWE style of booking, right?
See, now I was trying not to say that.
I'll say it.
Yes, 100%. It felt so WWE to me. And again, it's not a knock. It's just not what I want here.
It's different from what we're used to with GCW.
And I got to meet Matt Cardona. It was awesome. He was great. Like I said, I got to meet Mance too. And usually I'm typically very, very shy when it comes to meeting the wrestlers. And I was proud of myself for kind of getting over myself and going to talk to these guys, which I've done before, but it's nerve wracking for me.
Yep. Right.
And, but they were so gracious. Mance was alone at his table. I'm like, you're the champ. What are you doing? And also he said he watched our show. I'm just saying, like,
hi, Mance. Thanks for listening.
I talked to him a little bit. So he said he likes to watch or listen to and watch podcasts instead of like looking at Twitter and stuff.
It's probably a good move.
So I respected that. And I feel like everybody was giving maximum effort on this night. Like none of the matches were bad.
Right.
But I could, when the doors break and then you see the styrofoam in the doors.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
No. It's a no for me. Like I hated it. Hated it. I wanted to see glass break.
Yeah.
Like that's where I'm at. And I think maybe it just comes down to where I have to pick and choose to which GCW shows I go to from now on to get that same feeling that I want from this.
Right. And that goes back to like the original point we made. It's like, it's tough to kind of figure out, like Jersey's understood they're going to do death matches there, I think, but anywhere else, it's kind of like, well, I mean, you could maybe guess by the card, like, if you have, like, two deathmatch guys in the main event.
But even then, we had Maki Ito and John Wayne Murdoch.
Right.
And I'm like, my hopes went through the roof. I'm like, okay, maybe we get, like, maybe, like, a bundle. Like, lights. Like, just, light to light.
Right, yeah.
Like, save it for the end of the show. We're going to do it with Maki. We're going to do it with Nick Gage. No, it didn't happen. It didn't happen. And it's just, I hate walking away feeling disappointed.
Right.
No, I love this. I love it.
Yeah. No, I totally get your disappointment. Like, you want the light tubes, obviously, and not getting them. I mean, it's a cock tease of the highest order. But, it's just, I think, you know, as we keep moving forward here, I think it's just going to be tough to figure out outside of Jersey, like I said, which shows have them and which shows don't, you know. But
I agree, sadly.
Yeah. But at least you had a good time, which is always the,
always. Yeah, I mean, it's not a bad time ever.
No, of course. I mean, being there alive is
it was long. It was long, and I was hungry. I had a hot dog, had some pizza, had a lot of drinks.
They should have advertised the hot dog as like a light tube.
The hot dog was pretty tasty.
Yeah, light tube in a bun or something. Yeah. A death match dog. As we go.
I would buy that. I would pay $12.
As we go to 2 days later in Asbury Park. Speaking of New Jersey,
there you go.
Can I Trust You was the name of the show. Alec Price and Marcus Mathers defeated CPF. Griffin McCoy defeated Tony Deppen. Fuego del Sol and Sam Stackhouse beat Charles Mason and Richard Holiday. Arez, Gringo Loco, and Jack Cartwheel defeated Main Aerial SAT of Ariel Van Gogh, Jay Lyon, and Joel Maximo. Manders defeated Matt Tremont in a death match. Blake Christian defended his world title against Masha Slamovich. Maki Ito defended the extreme title against Ali Catch. Genelesis of Joey Janela, Megan Bain, defeated Broski Jimmy and Mance Warner. The Legion of Rot of Frightmare and Hollow Wicked defeated Los Macizos. And in the main event, another no contest is between Speedball and Raj Desi, the former Jinder Mahal. So I need to ask you, what are your thoughts on Jinder Mahal?
I'm not going to lie. I thought he looked very impressive. Mm-hmm. I feel he's overprotected. What are we doing?
Yeah.
And a no contest with Mike Bailey. But he's not one of my favorites. Mm-hmm. But it seems like GCW could be a nice spot for him.
Yeah. To me, again, I half understand the no contest in the Effie match, because obviously we'll get to it later. That's a feud that's going to continue. But I don't know. Did you need it in the Speedball match? Like, even if you want him to win, like, Speedball mm-hmm. can eat a loss. Like, he's fucking Speedball. Like, why? Like, I don't know. And the fact that they're doing it in the main event too, it's like, it's a way to not send the crowd home happy. But I mean, the rest of this show, what I saw was pretty good. Manders and Tremont beat the shit out of each other. There were no light tubes, but they did have the gusset plates there. So that
I love those.
That was at least something. But that was a huge spot for Manders and a big win for him, too. We'll get to he's got a big deal coming up, as we'll talk about later. But the main event, just the fact that it was another no contest kind of bugged the hell out of me. But I guess it is what it is at this point. Like, we're just going to have to, and it's been happening on seemingly every show, or in some cases multiple times per show. But the fact that it was the main event too, it's like, it's not the best for me.
And somebody else I wanted to point out here in the set is Joey Janela. Mm-hmm. Ever since Mania Weekend?
Yeah.
He's a huge star. What are we doing?
Like, so he was in the hospital for a little bit.
I knew he was injured a tiny bit.
But on this show in Asbury Park is when he came back, and he came back wearing like a medical smock, as if he had just gotten out of the hospital. So that was pretty good. But yeah, to your point, I mean, he's got a big match coming up, homecoming weekend. But I mean, since it's been like a slow build to this, I'm assuming eventual Joey Janela Mance Warner match coming at some point, like a big blow off. I'm guessing that's kind of where they're going with it.
Okay.
But I mean, since then, it's just been since Mania, it's just been a slow build with Joey, Mance, the world title, all that stuff. And you factor in the Blake stuff too, with him having his own world title. It's just, it feels more convoluted to me than it really needs to be.
It's too much wrestling. It's overbooked.
Yeah.
Like, again, I'm not trying to be like this. But and it's like the evolution of any promotion, and I've learned this just from going through different promotions, and I understand it. I can't get on board with it. It makes, it's too precious. You know what I mean? Like, it's too about itself, and I've just always loved the spirit and vibe of GCW that didn't, it never fell into those sort of tropes about its own promotion.
Right.
And I feel like we're starting to do that with these nonsense no contests and this weird protection of some guys. Like, I just feel like this should be a free for all.
Yeah. Like, I don't mind a promotion evolving, right? Every company, every wrestling company.
It's going to happen.
It's going to happen. It has, you have to evolve at some point. But you also can't forget about what brought you to the dance in the first place.
That's my feeling as well.
You know, like, I mean, you're still getting hardcore stuff, right? Like the doors, you're getting doors and chairs and shit. But it's not like the real hardcore stuff like that. I mean, it's safe. There were a couple matches with tubes here. But I mean, as far as like real death matches, like there was two of them throughout this entire month, which like when we first started this show, it felt like we were seeing two per show, you know? Mm-hmm. So they've definitely cut that way
down.
But like that's the thing for me is like, yeah, they're going to evolve. It happens to every wrestling promotion. But, you know, don't forget, quote unquote, don't forget where you came from, you know.
Well, my question is like, is this a deliberate thing they're doing, you know?
I've been wondering that.
Or is it just these venues? It's the cities where you book. Can you not do these type of matches? Is it restriction in that way? And then you kind of lean more into the storytelling and setting up for future stuff. And I don't want to set up for future stuff. I mean, a little bit, sure. Like,
right.
Like we've talked about before, we did the Mance and Effie stuff. We do like ghosts of storylines in here, but not everything needs to be that. And again, I know that light tubes and blood, violence, it's not for everybody. Not everybody
right. No, totally.
And I get it.
Yep.
It's just for me. Like, and that's how I feel. And I started doing this because of how I felt about this promotion. And I can definitely see, like, the way we've watched it has evolved and the way we've talked about it has evolved.
Yeah. I think the tell... So... I mean, we're going to get into upcoming in just a second here, but like, I think the tell, so they're in Japan as we're recording this right now, like they're doing shows in Japan. In Japan, usually they get super violent on those shows. Like there's usually a couple of death matches per show. I think that'll be the tell. Like if we don't see a lot of death matches on those two or three Japan shows, then I think it'll be like a storyline thing, because Japan in the past and that the buildings they're running in Japan in the past have let them do all kinds of deathmatch stuff. So I think if we don't see any in Japan, it tells me that it's more of like a storyline thing with Matt Cardona being the general manager type of deal.
I think so too.
But so we'll see. I think that'll be a good gauge, pardon the pun, as to what the future will be as far as deathmatches go.
Alrighty, Maddie. We're going to talk about some of our match picks of the month. What do you got?
So Mance Warner versus Hoodfoot, like I mentioned before, was
Hoodfoot is a fucking crazy name.
Great name. This is a very fun death match, just super violent. To your point, you know what you would want in a match. It's kind of what this match is, like just super violent, all kinds of glass and light tubes and blood and just. Really fun match. Another great, just hardcore brawl from Mance, which he's fantastic at. Maybe the best in the company right now as far as hardcore guys go. Just another great title defense under his belt. And to see it just, I mean, Mance was bleeding buckets. Hoodfoot's arms were all cut up and shit. So
nice.
Just, yeah. You wanted a death match. That's the one to go watch. It was really good. And I will also throw a nod to Speedball versus Akira from the Bloodsport show. Because
3 minute match.
A 3 minute match, and they just beat the piss out of each other for 3 minutes. It was awesome. I mean, Akira had blood all over his face. I think Speedball had Akira's blood on his face too.
Oh, shit.
From one of the kicks. So, yeah, I mean, one of the best, like, sub 5 minute matches I think I've ever seen. So, yeah, definitely seek out that whole Bloodsport show, honestly, like I said. But if you've got to pick one match, I think that's probably the one from that show that you should check out.
All right, so I'm going to pick a Mance Warner match as well from Cleveland versus Cool Ass Andy. No, just kidding. Not going to do that one. I'm going to pick the Matthew Justice match.
Yep.
That Mance Warner had. It was the best match on the card that night in Cleveland. I thought that Mance took it to a emotional level that, you know, I think he's getting known for.
Yeah.
Kind of having these low key emotional matches, like with your Effies, and there's a lot of like hate and like, you know, just kind of evilness infused into his matches. He's so good at being a heel. And he's such a sweet guy when you talk to him. It's so weird. It's so weird because he's just like so soft-spoken and stuff. But then when he's healing it up, he really turns it on and really comes across. They had a long match, and they did some great spots. And it was good storytelling, Matthew Justice being Mance's old partner.
Yep.
So that was cool. And you know, I wanted to talk a little bit about the Matt Hardy and Nick Gage match, but look, it's not making my match of the month. It's not. It's not a shout out. It's a what the fuck, man.
Yeah. And that was what I said when they announced it. Like, what are we, what the fuck indeed? Like, what are we doing? Like, just super weird.
And I don't know if it's like just a matter of like the actual physicality of what Matt Hardy is capable of in the ring. But look, you're in there with Nick Gage.
Yeah.
This man doesn't look like he should be able to do any of the fucking shit he does in there.
Really?
So if you can't hang with Nick Gage, then what are we fucking doing is how I feel, especially in a GCW main event.
Like, it hurts me to watch Matt Hardy walk.
Yeah.
It's real rough.
I'm not saying he looked bad.
Yeah.
It just, none of it was suited for a match, and then they didn't even really finish it.
Yeah.
And it was just felt so cheated in that moment.
And the finish certainly didn't help, obviously. But
no, absolutely not.
It turns out 30 years of jumping off of ladders onto hard surfaces will fuck you up a little bit. Who knew?
Yeah, but how about you don't go to a deathmatch promotion if you can't hang?
Right. And that's the thing, too. Like, if they're putting you in a big spot with Nick Gage in the main event of the show on a big wrestling weekend, SummerSlam weekend.
Yeah.
It's like...
You saying that just makes me feel so validated. And I really did give myself shit about this show and how I felt about it.
Yeah.
And
then you do that finish on top of all that.
Yeah.
Too.
Yeah.
It's just, it's weird. It's weird, I think, is the best way to describe it.
Disappointing.
Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah.
I think that had a lot of potential there for me. And I thought it was going to save the show. And it kind of did not. Save this show for me. All right. What song should I play? Fuck. I don't know. Let's do this one. Oh, shit. going to let it go more, but I think we'll stop it. What do we got coming up?
Well, as we're recording this tomorrow, they'll be in Tokyo for The Sky is the Limit, as Kikutaro will face Danhausen. That'll be a comedy match like you read about. Kikutaro is one of the funniest wrestlers in Japan. Just the stuff he does, he's fucking hysterical. Okay. And Danhausen's Danhausen. So that'll be something interesting. Miyu Yamashita will face Broski Jimmy. Joey Janela will face Marcus Mathers. Alex Zane and Gringo Loco will face Masha Slamovich and Rina Yamashita, returning to GCW. I believe Rina has had visa issues. That's why she hasn't been around. Okay. I think that's why she hasn't been. I don't know if she's been on since Mania, on Mania weekend, obviously.
It seems like we haven't talked about her.
Yeah. We have Aja Kong, Mao, and Masashi Takeda versus Ali Catch, Dark Sheik, and Effie. Good Lord. The great Sasuke is going to face Maki Ito.
Bet that's so cute. I love that.
Yeah, I can't wait for that. And in the main event, it is Mance Warner defending the GCW title against Manders. So that's presumably why Manders beat Matt Tremont in Asbury Park. That should be a great brawl. This show looks great. It's always a blast seeing great Sasuke do his fucking insane shit that he's still doing at 55 years old, or however old he is, the maniac. So looks like a great show. And I think this will be one of the shows where, like, I could see Mance and Manders being like a legit death match, you know? So we'll see.
Especially in Tokyo.
Right. And there's one match on the next show that'll almost certainly be a death match. But so then we go to the next day for still in Tokyo for You Only Die Once, as Joey Janela will face Danhausen, Effie, Broski Jimmy, and Andreza Giant Panda in a five-way scramble. I believe Andreza Giant Panda is quite literally a person in a panda suit.
Sweet.
So that'll be something. Ali Catch and Dark Sheik will face Kaya Torabami and Shoko Nakajima. Guaranteed I butchered those. Gringo Loco will face Alex Zane. Masha Slamovich defends the JCW title against Marcus Mathers. Rina Yamashita defends the ultra-violent title against Manders. So presumably that'll be your death match on that show. And in the main event, Mance Warner defends the GCW title against Maki Ito.
That sounds fun, too.
Yeah, those are two really fun, really good shows. I hope they deliver, because they go to Tokyo every year, and all those shows have been super fun from what I've seen. So hopefully this continues that trend. Then that weekend, we go to No Signal in the Hills 4 in L.A. from the Ukrainian Cultural Center. Rich Swan will face Sydney Akeem. Megan Bain will face Blake Christian in an effort to bring every wrestler I can't stand to GCW. Chavo Guerrero is here, as he will team with Los Mestizos to take on Jack Cartwheel, Gringo Loco, and Arez. Yeah. And then Broski Jimmy and Mance Warner will face Maki Death Kill. Ugh, Chavo, good Lord, what are we doing? I know. Go on.
Look. We mark out over some of these old school names that GCW likes to bring back, your Bob Armstrongs and whatnot. But I don't think Chavo's going to make that list.
No, I'd rather see Eddie wrestle now than Chavo, quite frankly, but that's me.
That would be interesting.
That'd be a hell of a trick. Save Me in Salt Lake City as we debut in Salt Lake City. Gringo Loco will face Jack Cartwheel. Blake Christian will face Marcus Mathers. Masha Slamovich will face Starboy Charlie. That's someone we haven't mentioned in a while. Joey Janela is going to face Tombstone Jesus. I hope Tombstone Mary and Tombstone Joseph are also there. And then in the main event, Mance Warner is going to defend the world title against Manny Lemons.
Not Manny Lemons, yeah. Maddie.
And his cousin, Steve Lime. then we... Oh, God. Thank you for humoring me with my terrible fucking joke.
You know I love it.
Homecoming Night 1 in Atlantic City on August 24th. Matthew Justice versus Zilla Fatu. Hello. Tony Deppen versus Sydney Akeem. Big fucking Joe versus John Wayne Murdoch. Ultramantis Black versus Danhausen. Mance Warner, Joey Janela, Blake Christian in a ladder match for the real GCW title.
Okay.
The Bollywood Boys and Raj Desi will take on Thrussey, and Nick Gage will face the returning Drew Parker in what will presumably be a death match where one of them may die. So this show is loaded, Jenny.
Yeah, that ladder match is the one to watch.
Yeah.
I will not miss that show.
Who you thinking?
My heart says it's time for Joey. It's Joey's time, God damn it.
No.
But I don't know. I really don't.
See, normally I would say it's probably time for Joey, but Mance has been so fucking good.
He has been world really champion. Good. It would seem so premature to take it away from him at this point. But it's that trouble, like, whatever starts getting over, kind of, you could see them leaning that way. But look, Joey's worked his fucking ass off, and I believe he deserves it.
Yep, totally.
But I want it to be bloody and gross and nasty. I don't want it to be slick and nice and WWE coded. See, I want it to be GCW.
I think this, there's at least, I could see 4 matches on this show being like deathmatch type stuff. So, and it is in Atlantic City, which is like the place where you get deathmatch stuff.
Apparently, I need to go there.
Yeah,
because I'm not seeing any other shows that are giving me what I want. So,
listen, say the word, we'll go.
All right.
I'm planning on going next year to Atlantic City.
Next year, you and me, bro. Let's
do it. Okay. The next night in Atlantic City, this is on the Sunday, Megan Bain will face Masha Slamovich. Fuego del Sol will face Charles Mason. Speedball will face Zilla Fatu. Well, that'll be good. Big fucking Joe, Drew Parker, and Lou Nixon will face Brandon Kirk, goddamn, easy for me to say, Hoodfoot and Matt Tremont in a 6-man tag. And then Matt Hardy and Nick Gage will face deathmatch royalty of Broski Jimmy and Matt Cardona. So Cardona returning to the ring on the 25th. Matt Hardy and Nick Gage teaming with each other is a thing I didn't have on my 2024 bingo card.
Well, I mean, it definitely came out that way, of course, at the end of the show in Cleveland. To me, it just smacks of no contest. I don't think there's going to be a winner in that match. And it's frustrating because once I start thinking shit like that, I'm not watching your promotion.
Yeah.
That's how I feel.
It feels to me like we are heading towards a Nick Gage, Matt Cardona deathmatch again, sort of like they did, like, I think it was 5 years ago at this point when Cardona won the world title from Nick Gage. It kind of feels to me like they're going to run that back at some point and have it be a death match with Matt Cardona being like the anti-death match guy. It feels to me like we're leading down that path again of Gage Cardona at some point.
At what point does Broski Jimmy turn on Maddie?
Yeah. See, I feel like that's
coming, right?
It's got to be coming soon, I would think. And he's been great as Cardona.
He has been great.
Especially with Cardona not being able to wrestle with the injury. Like, he's been great at. And honestly, I didn't think it was a thing that had any legs
when
they randomly main evented that show, but it's worked. So I do feel like it's going to happen at some point. It's just a matter of when, I think. I don't know if it'll necessarily. Yeah, it could be. But just seeing fucking Matt Hardy and Nick Gage team with each other is just like throwing me through a
wild
fucking loop. It's real weird, but here we are. And then finally, we go to August 31st in Chicago. Live Fast, Die Young, as Maki Ito will face Kylie Ray. Megan Bain will face Miyu Yamashita. Mustafa Ali returns and faces Sydney Akeem. And then presumably, if Mance Warner wins, this will be for the world title. But Mance Warner will face Gringo Loco on this show. So that should be I think they've wrestled each other once before, and it was like a real, like, kind of really violent for Gringo Loco, which we haven't seen him do a lot of. And it was more of a Mance match than it was a Gringo Loco match, and it was great. So hopefully they can recreate. Why can't I talk all of a sudden? It's a damn stroke. Recreate that in Chicago.
Yeah, I really like the pairing of Mance and Gringo Loco.
Mm-hmm.
I want to end it on a positive note. Tell me some good things about GCW real quick, since we said that.
I mean, listen, Homecoming looks fucking great.
Yep.
I mean, Night One looks top to bottom, like, insane. Getting Tony Deppen back, he hasn't been around that much.
Ah, yes.
That's what I wanted. I knew there was another question I wanted to ask you. What did you think of Sydney Akeem?
Good. Like, good. Yeah. But I was... Yeah. Eh. I'm still forming opinions.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Pretty much is how I felt about that. It was...
I think his finisher is fucking wild looking. That,
yeah,
like,
it
triple,
is.
Triple backflip thing. Mm-hmm. But I think it's smart that they're putting him in there with, like, Gringo Loco, Tony Deppen.
I think so, too.
You
yeah.
know? But, yeah, just getting back to Homecoming, those shows, both of them, look great. So, and it's in Atlantic City, which those crowds are always awesome. In theory, we're going to get at least one death match on that weekend. I'd be shocked if we don't get more than one, especially on night one of that show. There's like I said, I think there could be realistically like four matches that could mm-hmm. legitimately be death matches on that show. So that should be good. The ladder match should be great. And I mean, it's probably the most loaded show they've had maybe since like spring break. I think like it's loaded.
Shit, I might have to do a last minute trip. Cause this stuff ain't sitting well with me currently. Yeah. I need like an infusion of deathmatch in my soul.
No.
That's how I feel.
Don't we all?
Yeah. I think we all do.
Mm.
Lots of opportunities coming up for that. So
yep.
I'm hoping to have a brand new attitude when we come next month, Maddie, to talk about some more GCW.
Well, if we get four death matches during Homecoming, I think that'll...
You think that'll help. Shut me up? You think I'll have to eat my words a little bit?
I don't think that's what I said, but...
Yeah, pretty sure that's what you meant.
That's you know me. I always shit talk you, Jen.
Well, that's true. You're the one who most indulges me in all of the bullshit.
Yeah, I'm the enabler, if anything.
You are, 100%. I blame you.
It's always my fault.
All right. So what else you got to promote real quick before we get out of here?
Right here on the North-South Connection, we are both on the Extreme Three-Way Dance, where we're covering ECW. We're in 1999, so check that out. Over on the Backbone Wrestling Network, check every show out on there. We're doing some great stuff on there. Highway to the Impact Zone lives over there now. YouTube Roulette is over there. All kinds of great stuff. So linking up luchas. Listen to all of it. Listen to everything. It's been a blast helping run that feed. So please listen to it. Subscribe on your favorite podcatcher app. I think that's what they call it. Podcatcher. I'm learning the lingo. But listen to all that. And you can find me on Twitter at
MSouza1991. You know, being part of the Backbone Wrestling Network is so nice to see you guys all working together and mm-hmm. getting shit done, keeping shit on track and on schedule. So kudos to all my favorite people
mm-hmm.
who live on the Backbone.
Mm-hmm.
And you can catch my shows here on North South on Wednesdays, most Wednesdays. This show, Talking Docs, and Exposition, which is an X-Men podcast. And then very soon, the return of Freak Out Drive-In,
mm-hmm.
which will be all across the month of October. And it is a live watch horror movie podcast. Cannot wait to return to mm-hmm. Fody. So excited for that. And thank you guys for listening. And do not forget that it is MDK.
All fucking day,
baby. Thanks for listening. We'll see you next time. You a dirty dog.